agency, Madam President, all of the colleagues and friends online. Thank you, Mark, for this invitation. I am here as a civil society organization. The International Commission of Jurists has been working, in fact, maybe helping establish many of these institutions and processes, including the Office of the High Commissioner, for the last 70 years. I understand that that our role in some of these presentations, especially given the time of the year, is to be a little bit of a Grinch. We are sometimes here to be a little less diplomatic and point out some of the problems. I do want to say that, of course, at the end of the year, this is, especially this year, a wonderful time of the year, Human Rights Day, looking at human rights defenders, 16 days against gender-based violence. And I think we're very glad to see the end of this really terrible year in many ways, full of anguish and anxiety. And of course, the end of the year usually brings the URG reports with Norway's assistance. And I do think it is a very useful and helpful report. I actually did sit down and read it in some detail. And Mark already pointed out some of the key thematic takeaways. And of course, he relied on very nice visuals and graphics. As lawyers, I was fascinated by the text. And so I want to go through some of the issues that were raised in the report that were addressed. And actually point out that one aspect that was really coming through in the report and reflects the ICJ's experience was that in many ways, the council was having an ordinary year, maybe in some ways even a better than ordinary year. And I think that really points out the maturity of the system, the commitment of the UN staff, of civil society, and of course the diplomats to step up, perhaps in the absence or maybe despite the absence or presence of some of the superpowers on the council, but of course also the enormity of the challenges facing us and the way that the pandemic really highlighted the importance of human rights in addressing many of the issues that face the entire world and therefore the entire UN system, not just the Human Rights Council. Mark already pointed out to the very interesting statement from the Secretary General regarding the disproportionate and disparate impact of the virus. Of course, this was felt around the world and it really highlighted the difference between people who were marginalized, people who had access to good healthcare and who didn't. And we saw this even in the wealthiest countries in the world, that the virus was experienced differently by different groups. And so it's clear that for our survival, we need improved protection and promotion of human rights. This requires states to support human rights financially, politically, to support human rights defenders and civil society, and of course the human rights mechanism within the UN. We can see that this kind of progress is necessary, and we can see that this kind of progress is possible, and we can also see that this kind of progress is absolutely not inevitable, that it takes quite a bit of effort. So I just want to point out a few areas where when we look, I hope, to the end of the pandemic, we can think about building back better, as people have talked about, and how to not just return to the status quo ante, to move on to a better system and better engagement and more centrality for human rights in terms of Geneva itself, in terms of other international mechanisms in New York and in The Hague, and most crucially, in reaching out to the people of the world, the communities on whose behalf the Human Rights Council, and I think all of us are working to try to improve their situation. I do want to add to the chorus of appreciation for Ambassador Tishy Fisselberger. I think our sense was that the work of the presidency allowed the council to move forward, and that's really, really quite important. We're aware that the presidency is coming to an end and that there's a debate around the next president. And We certainly hope that the next president will continue, will maintain and even strengthen the protection of civil society space, address acts of reprisal and defend the institutional integrity of the council and the optics around the institutional integrity of the council. This is a decision for the council, and we look forward to having a great outcome for this at time sensitive discussion. The discussions around COVID-19, we heard from several of the speakers, were quite important. I do want to highlight the importance of special procedures in the human rights system, who also really kind of showed they were able to respond with their areas of thematic focus. And this was quite important for highlighting different aspects of the pandemic and how it was being felt by people around the world. I think that was another area of credit for the human rights system as a whole. We were, of course, a little bit disappointed that at this time, some of the states actually took a tried to curtail the independence of special procedures, and we were pleased that the discussion moved to the more positive engagement channel around the Coordinating Committee of Special Procedures. One thing that came out really importantly, looking at the Secretary General's call to action and looking at the action of the Human Rights Council, and in some ways its leadership, both in process, but in substance, is the importance for all of, especially for us in Geneva, especially the diplomatic corps in Geneva, to strengthen the links between the Human Rights Council and other agencies, other UN agencies and other global agencies. It's absolutely clear that we have to work more closely with the World Health Organization in terms of the pandemic, with the WTO regarding the distribution of vaccines, and all the other UN agencies that are that each have in their own way addressed the pandemic, but we hope that these can all be brought together. And this is an area where we hope that the diplomatic corps, especially in Geneva, will be helpful. You may all engage with these different institutions, but in fact, each of them has a different civil society ecosystem that is often quite separate, and we often are not involved in. The ICJ has been trying to improve that engagement, and we really would appreciate your help. The report pointed out some of the important country issues that were taken up. Mark mentioned Belarus. We were very pleased to see strengthened accountability processes in Venezuela, Yemen, Libya, Burundi. These were important, and we are very pleased to see the council continue to look at effort, to look at means of strengthening accountability for human rights violations. This is an area where the ICJ has been working on building bridges to The Hague and to New York, but of course, the link between human rights and violations of international law has led to very interesting developments at the International Criminal Court and now even the International Court of Justice. And the ICJ has been working with some of the member states in Geneva, the Kingdom of the Netherlands, Finland, to try to bridge that gap between The Hague and Geneva. And we hope that that trend will also continue. And finally, one of the very interesting areas of development, again, as pointed out by the URG report, was somewhat of a stripping of the taboo against taking on some of the superpowers and touching on issues that were previously viewed perhaps as too sensitive. The report points out the very interesting development of a joint statement on China and violations of human rights there. Simply on a process ground, this was interesting. And it was, of course, very interesting that China responded with two joint statements itself. So at least that issue is getting the debate it deserves. And the United States, in its absence, also came under scrutiny. We've talked about the discussion around racism and police violence, and we think that was an absolutely essential debate to have, and we hope that this kind of debate will continue. As the report points out, there were numerous other areas that we could not discuss accountability as much as we wanted. In the Philippines, in Sri Lanka, in India, in Egypt, the council danced around these issues, but didn't fully engage with them. But we hope that there is indication that we will. Finally, let me end by saying that there were some very interesting thematic discussions that we were very pleased to see and we hope will develop. The discussion around business and human rights treaty, I think, is very important for the ICJ. We very much welcome the resolution on prevention that was put forward by Switzerland, Sierra Leone, Norway, and Uruguay. The right to a healthy environment led by the Costa Rica mission. The strong resolution on discrimination against women and girls. And again, we were a little disappointed that there were some of the issues, as Mark discussed, the debate around societal framing. We view these as fairly clear international legal issues, but the debate is quite important. So let me end by saying that looking through the text of the annual report from URG, it was very important to see that debates continued, that they were able to take effect at a fairly high level. Of course, we missed being able to engage in face-to-face discussions and some of the important lobbying and information sharing in the Serpentine and around. But as the president, Madam President, pointed out, the fact that technology and adaptability and flexibility allowed us to continue allowed some important discussions to take place despite the unprecedented restrictions we face are a huge victory. It is true, as Madam President pointed out, that there were increased restrictions on civil society. I think it's important to talk about these. We don't want this to become the new normal where civil society gets less access to the council, but we also do want to see if we can take advantage of this adaptability and the use of new technologies to improve access so that people who cannot come to Geneva for a variety of reasons do have access, are able to speak, and that we can save some costs, we can save some carbon footprinting, and that we can move forward with the response that shows that the human rights system is genuinely central, that the Secretary General's call to action is one that is heeded by the states, and that the member states will respond with the appropriate level of support for the human rights pillar in the UN. That means financial support, political support, legal support, and that they will allow civil society and human rights defenders who are crucial for this system to operate to engage more and to provide all of the information and inputs that and expertise that we have from around the world. I thank the Human Rights Council and the presidency for allowing us to go to allowing us to work as well as we did. I hope that the pandemic is at an end and that we can come back and genuinely heed the call to action. And I really appreciate the support of member states who have allowed us to participate in these discussions. And for member states who haven't, I guess a call for you for the Christmas season in my role as the Grinch. But we will continue to work and we appreciate your support. So thank you for inviting me. And I hope that the ICJ in its next 70 years we'll see a greater improvement for the Human Rights Council and its central role in the development of a better world. Thank you very much.